Hi, this is Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Welcome to the weekly top three, the top three things on our mind here at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets for the week of March 18th, 2019. The weekly top three is a regular segment on The Michael Duke Show. The show broadcasts on Facebook Live and via streaming audio from the show's website, weekdays from 6 to 8 a.m. I join Michael on the show each Tuesday morning from 6:20 to 7 a.m. for a discussion between the two of us about our three issues. We post the podcast of our discussion following the show on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook, YouTube, and SoundCloud pages, and on my website at bgkeithley.com. You can find past episodes of the weekly top three also at the same locations. Keep in mind that in addition to these podcasts, during the week, you also can follow and participate in the discussion with us of these and other issues affecting Alaska's fiscal and economic condition by following us on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page and through our posts on Twitter. After a brief discussion at the start of the controversy surrounding the treatment of the governor's proposed budget earlier this week in a House Finance Education Subcommittee hearing, we turn to our top three. First, we update our 10-year outlook of the Alaska fiscal situation to reflect the spring revenue forecast, and it doesn't get any better. Second, we compare the impact of PFD cuts versus a flat tax from the perspective of the average Alaska family. A flat tax is clearly better for the average Alaska family than PFD cuts. And third, we discuss what is driving the growing federal deficit that's reflected in President Trump's newly proposed budget. And now, let's join Michael.
Quickly, your comments on this whole process of, a complete change to how the subcommittee process is supposed to work. I mean, that's where all the down and dirty is supposed to be done, is in the subcommittees, so it doesn't all fall into the, you know, onto the plate of the main finance committee. And yet it seems like here it's just they've just started to ramrod this whole thing.
Yeah, it is. And the thing that strikes me the most about this is the level of disrespect for the governor and the governor's budget. The typical process is there is something called an adjusted base, which is something that Ledge Finance puts together, not the governor, but Ledge Finance puts together, that sort of tries to take the prior year's budget and take out one-time items and adjust a few things and give a starting point so that legislators, as they're thinking about the budget process, sort of have some baseline to start thinking about. But that's typically all the adjusted base is useful for. Then the governor proposes his budget, and then most of the discussion is about the governor's budget. Do we want to keep these items? Do we want to amend these items? Do we want to? But there's a lot of discussion about what the governor's proposed. What the process that Representative Ortiz described yesterday is extremely dismissive of the governor and the governor's role in all this. Basically, it says we're going to take the adjusted base, something that was just sort of to give you some sense of what was going on, what last year's budget would look like if rolled forward to this year's, something that's more just sort of a template, and it's elevating it to the primary document and essentially saying we're going to vote up or down on what the governor's proposed to do, no debate on that, no discussion about that. And because we're the majority, obviously we're going to vote down the governor's proposals, it looks like, and just keep going with this adjusted base. And that's just, I mean, you're not giving the constitutional process that contemplates the governor proposing a budget and the legislature discussing it and disposing of it, yes, but at least discussing it and giving it weight. You're not going through that process. And I frankly, in all the years I've followed Alaska and in years prior to that, when I've gone back and talked to people about what the older process was, I can't find anybody who recalls a process that is as dismissive of a governor and as disrespectful of a governor as what the House Finance Committee appears to be rolling out here.
Yeah, no, it's astonishing to me, and again, to watch the process just compete. I mean, because we have to admit that all these legislative things and these processes are all based on tradition. I mean, that's how the Roberts rules, and they don't work under Roberts rules. There's another set of rules they work under. But, I mean, it's the same kind of thing. This is the tradition. This is how debate and these kind of things are supposed to work. And it seems like for the last 2 years, the Democrats have just thrown that playbook out and said, we're going to do it the way we want to do it, and if you don't like it, suck it. I mean, that's kind of how they're treating this whole process. We're in charge. We've got the gavel now, and it's kind of like bullies in the playground. It really is in that kind of way.
Yeah, but this is taking it to a new level. I mean, I appreciate what you're saying about the last legislature, the last 2 years, but they treated the governor respectfully, and they treated the governor's budget submissions with appropriate discussion and review. This is an entirely new level. Yes, they're treating the minority, sort of like the minority, and that's not altogether well. But the thing that really bothers me about this process is the disrespect they're showing the governor and the governor's budget.
Yeah.
The constitutional process is the governor submits a budget. And yes, the legislature disposes of it, but the legislature at least needs to consider it. And this sort of what lawyers would call rocket docket approach, which is we're not going to discuss these things. We're just going to vote up or down. And we all know how we're going to vote. So we're just going to get through. We're just going to wipe out the governor's budget in one fell swoop. It's disrespectful.
Yeah.
It's disrespectful of this governor, and it's disrespectful of the constitutional process.
Absolutely. Well, let's move on to number one, because I think it's all these things kind of tie together. Recently, the Senate and some of the folks out there all of a sudden opened their eyes and realized, hey, wait, wasn't there supposed to be a constitutionally mandated long-term outlook on what's going on around the state of Alaska? That's one of the things that hasn't been produced yet. And that kind of raised some eyebrows, but you've been talking about that for a while. And so you yourself have put together a 10-year outlook of what things are supposed to look like. And now we've got a new updated revenue forecast, which basically says, hey, oil revenues are actually going to go down farther. What does your 10-year outlook say?
Well, it's what I've done is I've taken sort of the last status quo we had, which was Governor Walker's 10-year plan that he put together in the last year of his administration, because the Dunleavy administration still hasn't done a 10-year plan, and taking Governor Walker's 10-year plan and then compared that from a spending standpoint to the revenues that we're projecting. We did that once when the fall revenue sources book came out. And we've updated it now for the spring revenue forecast that's done that was published last Friday, and the difference between spending, status quo spending, which appears to be, I mean, just to go back briefly, appears to be where the House is going with their adjusted budget approach. The difference between the spending and the revenues is just eye opening. I mean, it's just stark. I think when I did the post, I said it's, you know, red ink as far as the eye can see. In each of the 10 years, even after you do Hammond 50-50, even after you take using POMV at various levels, I've looked at it at various levels, and take a portion of those revenues coming from the permanent fund earnings reserve, and applying that to government. Even after you do that, we're talking about deficits that are $1 billion plus each and every year for the next 10 years. And then I took it a step further and I said, well, what does that mean in terms of, I mean, let's try to get this deficit down to terms that Alaskans commonly deal with. And so I did it in terms of the PFD. And we would, the average PFD cut that we would need to take per year, per person, per PFD, per year, for the next 10 years to make up this revenue loss or this gap, this deficit gap, we would need to take a PFD cut per person of $1,900 per year, every year, for the next 10 years. And that's, what is it? That's $5,600 per family of four over 10 years. So it's $5,600 per year per family of four. And that is what, that's $56,000 per family of four over the 10 years
right.
that would be taken out of their PFDs in order to make up this deficit. I did it another way on a flat tax because I think that's the way we ought to be comparing those two. And it's a flat tax of 4.8% averaged over the 10 years to make up the deficit. So it's, I mean, we've got huge red ink numbers that we're looking at. And when you look at it on the 10-year, I mean, I'm surprised that the Dunleavy administration hasn't come forward with something like this on their own, because you can look at the deficit on a 1-year basis and it's sort of, you know, it's shocking and you sort of, you know, wonder how we're ever going to deal with that. But when you look at it on a 10-year basis, when you roll that over 10 years and you look at, you know, the repeated deficits that we're facing over the 10 years, it really sort of overwhelms you. And I think you come to a much better understanding of why Governor Dunleavy is proposing the cuts he's proposing. We can't live this way. I mean, we've lived this way the last 7 years because we've drawn down $18 billion in savings over the last 7 years to pay for this stuff. We don't have that amount of money remaining in the fiscal reserves to be able to do that. We've drained them down. We're hitting zero in terms of our fiscal reserves. And so when you look at this red ink, you know that we don't have the reserves to cover this anymore. And it's just sort of overwhelming. So it really, I think it does a great job of making Governor Dunleavy's case of why we need to do these spending cuts, because we're going on this trail year after year after year after year. We're facing PFD cuts or flat tax year after year after year after year. And there is no way out of this, given the revenue forecasts and the sort of the status quo spending, unless we go down a different track.
Brad Keithley is our guest, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We're talking about the long-term forecast, the ramifications of what's going on right now in the House and the Senate, and what we can do to fix it. So we look at these numbers, Brad, and we realize that here's the horrible truth. The horrible truth is we're spending too much. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. We're spending too much, and we've got opportunities here to fix that, and yet those opportunities are being shunned at every turn. Both in the House and in the Senate by both the Democrats and the Republicans. And it seems like their only answer thus far is to just continue to take the dividend. That's been the kind of the mantra that you've seen. It's the same mantra that the special interests have picked up on and now are testifying on in all these meetings. Just take my dividend and fix it. And the problem is that even taking the dividend in the long run is not a real viable solution.
Yeah, Ed King did an analysis in his presentation to House Finance that showed that we've entirely consumed the dividend in 2 or 3 years if we keep going down this road. And by the way, while you were talking, I redid my math. It's not $5,600. It's $7,600 for a family of four per year. And so it's $76,000 that we're taking out of the hands of middle and lower income Alaska families. $76,000. That we'd have to rip out of the hands of middle and lower income Alaska families in order to pay for this style of government over the next 10 years. So you just sort of get stunned when you look at what 10 years when you look at a 10 year forecast and see what the impact is going to be if we keep going down this road.
I'm so frustrated, Brad, by this whole process because, I mean, we could see the handwriting on the wall. We could see that this is unsustainable. You cannot drag 5% of Alaskans' income if you want the flat tax route, or $7,600 out of the average family of four year after year, and expect people are going to stand still for it. I mean, they will move with their feet. I mean, Alaska's a great place, but it does get pretty tough to live here, cost of living, et cetera, et cetera. This will cause a migration out. The canaries in the coal mine will become a flock of seagulls as they leave the state of Alaska, leaving an even smaller pool to tax. And if all we do is protect the public sector at the cost of the private sector, we're going to doom this economy to a repetitive cycle of destruction.
Yeah, it's exactly right, Michael. And the thing that again, I mean, I've focused on a lot, we've talked about a lot, but we're doing this on the backs of middle and lower income Alaska families. By doing it through PFD cuts, we're barely touching the income of the top 20%, but we're taking a serious, I mean, $7,600 a year for a family of four, $76,000 over 10 years. We're taking a serious cut out of the income stream of middle and lower income Alaska families. And I, you know, you're exactly right. I don't know how they deal with it. We increase poverty levels significantly, push more people over to public welfare programs. As a result of that, we deplete what people are putting aside for education for their kids. We deplete their ability to pay the higher cost of living in Alaska. We think we have an imported workforce now running Alaska. I mean, you start moving people in the middle and lower income brackets out of the state, we're going to have an even greater imported workforce into the state. It's just the wrong policy. It's a policy that's driven in the first instance by wanting to keep government services and government employees going at the same level that we've built it up to. And then the second driver is we don't want the top 20% contributing any significant share toward the cost. We want to push the cost entirely to middle and lower income families. Governor Dunleavy has seen these numbers. He knows where it's headed. And if I were him, I would be talking much more about not just this year, but where we're going in the future. I mean, where we're taking ourselves over the next 10 years, yep. 20 years, yep. 30 years, if we don't get this under control. We've hit an inflection point. We're out of reserves. We no longer have the ability to fund government, keep this party going by drawing down savings accounts that we've built up over time. We've got to confront this issue, and if we don't confront it by cutting spending, then we're going to confront it by taking money out of the hands, at least what the Senate and others have proposed, by taking it out of the hands of middle and lower income Alaska families.
Absolutely. I don't understand why he's not focusing more on this 10-year plan. It could be just the tool that he needs to beat the legislature into submission on this thing through the public will. I mean, this whole process is, I mean, I'm reaching a kind of a frustration level here watching this stuff happen and realizing, you know, they seem to have this thing on rails. Like you said, the rocket docket syndrome. I mean, they are moving towards the cliff and they just don't see to, you know, they don't want, seem like they want to put the brakes to it at all. They just want to keep pouring the coal to it.
Yeah, I mean, they want to avoid the discussion that we just had, Michael. I mean, they want to avoid the discussion where the minority, the Republican minority, is able to make the point that, look, this is not only what we're doing this year, but this is, look at it over the next 10 years. Look at what you're doing to Alaska families. Look at what you're pushing, the financial burden you're going to be pushing to Alaska families over the next 10 years. Is that what we want to be doing, or do we want to be looking at what the governor's proposed in terms of cuts? That entire conversation gets wiped out in the way that Senator or Representative Ortiz ran the committee, and it looks like that's the template for the way the other finance subcommittees are going to be run. That entire conversation about where are we headed, what are we doing, we're pushing this burden to middle and lower income Alaska families, or to all Alaska families if we use a flat tax. We're making judgments here that have significant financial consequences to Alaska families, and all that discussion is being wiped out. And that's to go back to my point earlier. That's the type of discussion that we're entitled to have. I mean, the governor proposes a budget. That budget should be discussed in the committee. That constitutionally, yes, the legislature disposes, but the legislature is supposed to give some deference to the governor's budget. And the proposal here to just wipe that out in one set of votes with no debate is just hugely disrespectful.
Right.
Of both the governor and the process, not being able to discuss the impact of these issues on Alaska families, not being able to discuss a comparison of the trade-off between what you're doing to Alaska families, lower, particularly lower and middle income, middle and lower income Alaska families, and the government is just it's just astonishing. I mean, the majority obviously wants to control the message; they only want their message out. That's what they're doing, but that's not what the constitutional process contemplates.
Kathy brings up a very interesting point, which we hadn't really discussed when I was talking about the outflow of the people most affected by these, by the what we've just been talking about in the future, this taking of the PFD up to $1,900 or a 4.8% flat tax or whatever it is, driving a large chunk of these people out. She makes an interesting point, which I hadn't considered. She said the top 20% are making their quote-unquote profits from the lower and middle class. I mean, the lower and middle class are carrying the burden now. If they leave, the top 20% will lose on that because then they'll have to pick. I don't know if they're seeing. See, this is the problem with this legislature. Historically, very, very short-sighted. Never really. There hasn't been a legislature in the last 30 years that has had a long-term vision for where the state is going. It's always been the next election cycle or 1 year down the road or whatever. Never a 5 or a 10 or a 15-year outlook have they really, given much thought to.
Yeah, exactly right. Exactly right. And Kathy's point about the impact on sort of the downstream impact on the top 20% is a good one. My guess is what they would just if they start down this road of using PFD cuts to fund government to fund the closing the gap, they'll just keep going down this road, and the outcome will be the burden will just be harder and harder on middle and lower income Alaska families. So I think the top 20% vision is they never pay for it. They just keep running the PFD down to zero, and then maybe they'll start cutting the cost to government because then it would start hitting their pocketbook. But right now I think their vision, I mean, Chris Birch has as much as said this, which is I'll take the PFD down to zero. I'm perfectly fine with taking the PFD down to zero, said Representative Birch last year, at least.
Right.
And so the vision is just keep status quo going, but on the backs of middle and lower income Alaska families.
Yeah, which again, if you look at it from the long-term perspective, makes absolutely no sense. I mean, we've got the opportunity to right the ship now. There's no sense driving it up onto the rocks, but it seems like, unfortunately, we've got the status quo folks, both on the left and the right, Republicans and Democrats, House and Senate, are all just bound and determined to drive the thing right up on the rocks, and that's where we're going to, that's where we're going to end up. We're back now with Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. It's his weekly top three, through which we've got through the number one. We're jumping up onto the number two now. Never seems to be enough time, Brad, never. Let's take a look at the impact on the PFD cuts on the state of Alaska and how an alternative, and I know some people in the chat room are going to go crazy over this because, we don't need a tax, we just need to cut. But unfortunately, we're not the ones driving this conversation. As I said earlier, it seems like our betters in the legislature, both Republicans and Democrats, have all decided that that there are other alternatives, and that's taking our money and taxing us in the form of a PFD cut. And you're proposing an alternative to that. So you look at the impacts of both of those. Let's talk about that.
So one of the I've talked a lot about comparisons of what a flat tax does to Alaskan families compared to PFD cuts. And I've always focused on a family of four, frankly, because I think that's a representative family and what a family of four would pay in the top 20% and then the other quintiles down to the lowest 20%. One of the pushbacks I've gotten on that over time is, well, you're distorting it by looking at a family of four, and you're distorting it by looking at it in all of these quintiles. You should look at it based upon just what the average, the median Alaska income and what the average family is. So I finally took some time this past week to take a look at that and use the numbers from the Census Bureau, the current numbers for Alaska from the Census Bureau, which is a median income of about $76,114. And the average Alaska household size, which is 2.81, and did the calculations based on that. And not surprisingly, given that the flat tax is better for 80% of Alaska families, it's better for the typical, the average Alaska family of earning the median income and the average Alaska family size of 2.81. The flat to close the $1.6 billion budget, or the $1.6 billion deficit that we have, we took a look at what it would take in terms of PFD cuts and what it would take in terms of a flat tax. For an average family of 2.81, it would be $7,000 of PFD cuts for that family per year to close the $1.6 billion deficit. And you can do this at $1.3 billion deficit, or $1 billion deficit, or any sort of deficit you want. The numbers all come out showing the same relationship between flat tax and PFD cuts. So for a family of 2.81, average Alaska family, mom and pop, and 0.8 of a child is what the average is. The PFD cut for that family to close the $1.6 billion budget is $7,000. That's roughly 9% of the income for that family. If instead you do it as a flat tax based upon adjusted gross income, which is what we've talked about in the past, the what's required of that family is a flat tax of $4,871, significantly less than what the PFD cut would take out of their family, take out of their income. 6.4% of their income to close the $1.6 billion deficit, as opposed to the 9.3% of their income resulting from PFD cuts. And then I did a chart, or posted a chart sometime this past week, that then breaks that down not only for the median Alaska family, but then again also for each 20%, the top 20%, the upper middle income, which is 60 to 80%, the middle, which is 40 to 60, the lower middle, which is 20 to 40% quintile, and then the lowest 20%. And across the board, all the way from upper middle all the way down to the lowest 20%, a flat tax comes in at a lower cost to the family, to our 2.81 family, than PFD cuts. The only income class that ends up paying more under a flat tax as opposed to PFD cuts is the top 20%. But the top 20% pays no different amount than as a percent of their income than any other income class. So right. to close the $1.6 billion budget, the top 20% would pay 6.4%. The upper middle would pay 6.4%. The average family would pay 6.4%. The middle would pay 6.4%. Lowest middle would pay 6.4%. The lowest 20% would pay 6.4%. You're not asking any more of the top 20% than you're asking of any other Alaska family by using a flat tax. And I think that's a huge benefit, as opposed to PFD cuts, which push the burden of funding government, of closing the gap off on middle and lower income Alaska families.
Well, and let me say this, Brad, I've been with you on this whole discussion about a flat. You and I have been talking about this for 3.5 years, I think, almost 4 years now, flat tax versus, and it's always been for me the option of saying, choosing my poison, picking my poison. If I'm going to take the poison, which one do I want? I want the one that is less harmful overall. That's why I've been on board with the flat tax. Unfortunately, with the way this government's going, with the way our legislature is going, you know, we've in the past talked about 2.5%, maybe 3%. Now we're talking about a full 5-6% of our income as this goes down more and more. I mean, even if you look at it as 6% of the income, how many families could absorb that? I've got less than 2 minutes here. How many families could absorb that kind of hit in the long run and still rationalize staying in the state of Alaska?
Well, and that's exactly right, Michael. I mean, closing a full $1.6 billion budget by taxing Alaskans, taking money out of Alaskans, is the wrong way to go. I mean, we need to have as much cuts as we can. But at some point, I mean, we've all seen the legislature and we've all seen the pushback that's going on. At some point, we're not going to get cuts that close the $1.6 billion. So you need to work through what the funding mechanism is going to be to close the remaining gap. Yes, a 6% tax, a 5% tax, a 4% tax, a 3% tax, all those are taxes on Alaskans, and all those are bad. But PFD cuts, I mean, here's the deal. PFD cuts are worse. I mean, for an upper middle income Alaska family, even an upper middle income Alaska family, an average Alaska family of 2.81, PFD cuts are a 7.4% tax to close a $1.6 billion deficit. On the average family, it's a 9.3% tax. On a middle income family, it's a 12.1% tax.
Right.
On a lower income, it's 20%.
Brad, I mean, the more that I look at this and the more that I realize that, I mean, not to put too fine a point on it, but our destruction is imminent. I mean, this really, if these legislators, if these politicians don't get a grip on it, I mean, as you point out, even the upper, and I'm probably fall between the median and the upper median income. And I can tell you right now, because I don't have a family of 2.8, I have a family of 6. That is a significant portion of my income, probably upwards of 14 or 15% when they start cutting into that kind of stuff. I mean, you get to the point where you're just like, how do we continue to make it and how do we justify it? And once they drain the PFD, once the permanent fund dividend is completely gone, I just don't see them having the appetite to really fix anything else. They will focus in on the ERA, and that 5.25 draw will be 5.7, 5.6, 7.8. Next thing you know, all those ad hoc draws continue. The ERA will be gone, and there will be no other option because they've protected the public sector at all costs.
Well, they protected the public sector, and Michael, the thing I add every time now onto that is they protected the top 20%. This isn't only about protecting the public sector. That's not all that's going on in the brain of those who are pushing PFD cuts. It's also about protecting the top 20%. They don't want to pay a proportionate share of the cost of government. The permanent fund dividend, cutting the permanent fund dividend, gives them a way out of them having to pay a proportionate share of the cost of government, and pushes it on the backs of middle and lower income Alaska families. That's what's going on here. It's not just, I mean, up until now when we've drawn down savings, it's really just been a tax on future Alaskans, right? We're not going to give future Alaskans the same sort of savings that this generation had when we hit our troubles. If we don't refill the CBR, when the next generation hits their fiscal difficulties, they won't have the solution yet. But that, up until now, we've been taxing future Alaskans by taking away a cushion for them and using it for ourselves. Now that we've gotten to this point, it's now the top 20% is saying, okay, we still don't want to pay, so let's find another way to push this away from us. And they're pushing it on middle and lower income Alaska families through PFD cuts. So yes, it's about protecting the government sector and protecting, you know, the healthcare industry that we've built up in this state through Medicaid. That's what the Medicaid debate's about. It's really protecting the healthcare industry. And yes, it's protecting the K-12 industry that we've built up. And yes, it's protecting the three university systems we've built up. That's part of it. But the other part of it is the top 20% saying, yeah, we want those things to continue because, you know, we got friends and neighbors and we've got contracts with those things. We want government spending in those areas to continue, but we don't want to pay for it. We want to push it off on lower and middle and lower income Alaska families. And we sort of come up with all these rationalizations like, well, you know, the PFD, that's really state money. That's not really, you know, citizens' money. And we're just taking back what's really state money. That's nothing more than a cover story for the top 20% not wanting to pay a proportionate share of the cost of government. And that's where all this is coming from. It's government employees, the government sector first, but it's then protecting the top 20% behind that.
I'm again reaching my frustration threshold here, because we look at this and we see that there is no acknowledgement of any of the things that we're talking about. I mean, I really wish that the governor would put out that 10-year plan, because if they put out the 10-year plan, it would be bold. I mean, you could do it and it's great, and they're just like, oh, it's some random guy putting it out there. But when you look at it and you could see it in bold black and white, or in this case, black and red, and you could see what's coming down the pike, people should start scratching their head going, well, how do we avoid that cliff? How do we avoid that fiscal cliff? You've said that for many years. And it just seems like we can't at this point. The movement in the legislature has been to just move on the easy money. The easy money right now is the dividend. Charlie points out in the chat room that the problem with any taxation approach is that the money doesn't show up immediately. The PFD is a ready pot of money for the legislature to grab, and they have, so they've already done it, so they know how easy it is. I just don't see any way back at this point unless something drastic happens.
Yeah, I think, and again, I mean, that's part of the reason why the majority is closing down this discussion in House Finance. They don't want to provide the opportunity for the minority to push back and say, look, this is what you're asking individual Alaska families to do. You're asking them to, you know, forego, if we restore the full $1.6 billion, you're asking them to essentially say they're going to take PFD cuts of $76,000 for a family of four over the next 10 years. And that's just they don't want to discuss it. They want to keep pushing it. I mean, they don't want to admit, they don't want to have a discussion about flat tax, even though you can do the number on the average Alaska family and show that a flat tax is better for an average Alaska family than PFD cuts. Even though you can show all the arguments, they don't want to discuss it. They just want to keep rocket docketing it toward the agenda they want. And that's not only House Finance, that's also on the Senate side.
Right.
They don't want to discuss flat tax. They just want to discuss PFD cuts.
And the worst part is that even people who are conservative and folks in this chat room, even they don't want to discuss a flat tax, even though that is the handwriting on the wall, is it's either going to be a PFD cut or some other form of tax. I mean, a PFD cut is a tax or some other form of tax. And even folks who are on our team don't want to discuss it because they are focused on the cut side. And I agree. I want cuts first. But if it's not feasible, which I think right now it's not, this is where we're at. We have to have this discussion. Hour two of Common Sense Radio. It is the Michael Duke Show, broadcasting live across the state of Alaska on this, your favorite radio station, and around the world at MichaelDukeShow.com. Thanks for coming back in and joining us. It is Tuesday, which normally means an hour or two, we're going to get a chance to talk to Chris Story, which we are here in the next segment. But I have done something unusual. I've asked Brad Keithley from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets to continue with us today into hour two, because we're up at crunch time. We are up to the crisis moment. We've been talking about what's happening, and all we're seeing from our legislature right now is business as usual, more of the same, going back, pushing the governor's budget off to the side and wanting to work off of last year's base budget and increasing the cost to Alaskans. And we've been talking about how that is going to be destructive to the future of the state of Alaska. Brad Keithley from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets continues with us. Brad, if you want to do a quick summation of what we did in the first two, and we'll jump on to number three of your top three, we could do that for the new listeners here at the top of the second hour. Let's go ahead and do that.
Sure. So the first issue we talked about was looking at where we're headed over 10 years. We've been focusing our debate on this coming year, and that's important. And we've been focusing on the deficit that we're facing this coming year and what we ought to be doing about it this coming year. But this isn't a one-year issue. It's not like if we can just get through this issue, it'll be different for the next 10 years. This is an issue that continues with it. So what we've done is we updated a 10-year forecast that we've done, looking at what would happen if we did status quo spending, sort of taking Governor Walker's last 10-year forecast as the spending base, and then updating it for the revenue forecast that came out last fall, and then updating it again this week for the, or this weekend for the revenue forecasts that came out, the spring revenue forecast that came out on Friday. And what you see when you do that is not only do we have a problem this year, but we have a problem for the next 10 years and decades beyond that if we don't get this under control. But looking at the difference between the spending, the status quo spending on the track we're on, and the revenue base that we have, even including 50% of the permanent fund earnings, as Governor Hammond intended, we see deficits of $1 billion plus over the next 10 years. Translating that into something, a currency that Alaska understand better, that's a 19, to close that deficit, that's a $1,900 PFD cut every year per Alaskan. For an Alaska family of four, that's a PFD cut of $7,600. Total that up over 10 years, and we're talking about PFD cuts of $76,000 for every Alaska family of four, regardless of income class. So it's staggering when you look at it beyond the 10 years. The number two, the second thing we talked about was comparing other ways of closing the gap. If we're going to have a gap, comparing other ways of closing the gap instead of using PFD cuts, because PFD cuts push the largest part of the burden off on middle and lower income Alaska families. And by middle income Alaska families, I don't just mean the middle 20%. I mean the middle 60%, the upper middle, as well as the middle, as well as the lower middle. We're talking about 80% of Alaska families, those middle classes plus the lowest 20, are feeling the greatest part of the burden. If we're gonna have to close this through taxing Alaska families, there are better ways to do it. One way we've looked at often, and frankly I think has a lot of merit, is doing it through a flat tax instead. And one of the other studies we did this week was to look at the impact of PFD cuts versus the impact of a flat tax on the average Alaska family. And using the Census Bureau, the average Alaska family has a median income of about $76,000, and the family size is 2.81, is what the Census Bureau tells us the average Alaska family size is. And when you focus in on the average Alaska family, PFD cuts of the size that we're talking about would take roughly 9% of that family's income, not only this year, but every year for the next 10 years. And if we don't get cuts, if we don't get spending under control beyond that, a flat tax would take 6.4%, which is a high number, but it's lower than what you get with PFD cuts, 9.2. And that's true. That relationship, a flat tax being lower than the impact of PFD cuts, is true for every income sector, from the upper middle all the way down to the lowest income Alaska families. That's 80% of Alaska families are better off with a flat tax than a PFD cut. The only sector that's not is the top 20%, but you're not asking a flat tax wouldn't ask any more from the top 20% than you're asking from any other Alaska income sector. The top, the middle income, lower income Alaska families would pay 6.4% under a flat tax. So would the top 20%. You're not trying to gouge them more. You're just asking them to contribute the same.
Which brings us, of course, to our final of our top three of the weekly top three, and how this all ties back in. And that, of course, moves on to the national level and the national budget and how it affects Alaska.
Yeah. So, President Trump released his proposed budget for the next fiscal year late last week, and we've started taking a look at that. And there's funny. I mean, the budget is out of control as the Alaska budget, roughly $1 trillion instead of $1 billion, which is the deficit we're dealing with in Alaska. $1 trillion. At the federal level, but it works out about the same. We're running about 25% deficits in 25% of spending is being funded through something other than revenues at the state level. It's about the same relationship at the federal level. And we took a look at what the impact, we and others have taken a look at where this deficit's coming from. And most times when you ask people, where is the federal deficit coming from? Most Alaskans will say, or a lot of Alaskans will say, well, it's Obama, that it was the Obama administration that did this. But when you start digging into it, you find that that's not really true. There is a portion of it that's coming from like interest expense and from programs that were created during the Obama administration. But 60% of this year's projected federal deficit is coming from legislation that was passed in the last 3 years. It was passed once the Republicans took control of Congress again. The 2018 budget agreement is a big part of that. And then the tax bill, the 2017 Tax Reform Act, which cut revenues, is another big part of that. Together, those account those things that have done. Been done within the last few years account for 60% of this year's projected deficit. Put another way, if Congress hadn't done anything in the last few years, if they hadn't passed any laws in the last few years, the coming year's deficit would be only $360 billion. It would be below the deficit that we had from 2008 forward. It would take us back to the deficit levels that were high historically, but were lower than what we've experienced since. It would take us back to deficit levels that we had last in the mid-2000s if Congress hadn't done anything these last few years. Because of Congress's actions, though, the deficit is not $360 billion. It's $897 billion. It is more than double the size of what the deficit would have been. And that's directly due to things that the Congress has done in the last few years under Republican control, signed by Obama when President Obama was still there, but then signed also by President Trump in terms of the 2017 Tax Reform Act and in terms of the 2018 budget agreement. So we're doing this to ourselves. We want to blame the impact of what's going on at the federal level on somebody else, on those who were in power long ago. But it's really those who are in power now that are enacting things that are having, you know, this escalating effect on the federal budget.
Right. And this shows exactly what I've been saying for years, which is it doesn't matter if you're wearing an elephant on your lapel or a donkey. You're both part of the problem at this point. And we're talking at the national level. That's historically been the case at the national level, where the spending has continued to run away regardless of who's in power. And ironically, sometimes it seems like even more so when the small g Republicans are in charge than when the Democrats are in charge. But the same thing is also happening in the state of Alaska. It's almost a case of monkey see, monkey do.
It is. I mean, we've built up this reliance on debt and on essentially, you know, taxing somebody else, taxing future Americans in the case at the federal level to deal with our problems. We're making this generation's life better, but at the expense of what we're leaving behind for future generations. And we're doing the same thing at the state level. I mean, draining savings over the last 7 years, draining $16 billion in savings over the last 7 years is a burden we're going to pass on to future Alaskans. They're not going to have the same cushion to call on when they hit their fiscal problems as this generation has had. We've taken it all for the benefit of ourselves. And now that we're at the end, and now that we've run out of savings, we're still looking for somebody else to take the burden of this. We're looking for the top 20% are looking at through PFD cuts are looking at middle and lower income Alaska families. It's a game about at both the federal and the state level. It's a game of not about how do I get this under control. It's who can I push the costs to. And at the federal level, federal level, we're pushing it to future Americans, and at the state level, we're now looking for some class that can't look out for itself as well, who don't have the lobbyists that the top 20% have. We're looking to push the burden down to the middle and lower income Alaska families. If we had everybody with an equal stake in the game, such as a flat tax, everybody would have an incentive to get costs under control. But as long as some are able to play the game of, I don't have to pay for it, I can push this burden off on somebody else, we can continue down, we can continue to let good times roll, we can continue to have high government spending, I'll just push the burden off on somebody else. As long as that's the game, we're never going to get spending under control, either at the federal level or at the state level.
Brad Keithley's our guest, Alaskans for Sustainable Budget. I've got about a minute here, Brad. I need us to sum up and talk about, you know, what can we do as Alaskans, as Americans? What can we do to fix this? Because there's a lot. I mean, there's hopelessness here. I mean, really, we feel like we're banging our head against the wall. What do we do?
We need to talk about the impact on average Alaska families. Once you do that, and once you start confronting the fact that an average Alaska family, an average of four, or an average of even 2.81, is being asked to take PFD cuts in the range of $50,000 to $70,000 over the next 10 years, I think that starts bringing home what we're doing to ourselves. And if we've got to close this with new revenues, if we're going to have a gap that needs to be closed with revenues, we need to talk about the impact of different ways of doing it on the average Alaska family, because then you realize that a flat tax is better than, even a flat tax is better than the PFD cuts as a way to go forward. Similarly, at the federal level, we need to be talking about the impact on average Alaska families, not only of this generation, but future generations. And what is this generation, the baby boomers, leaving behind for future generations? We're leaving a train wreck behind for average American families going forward. We're leaving a huge debt burden just to make our lives better. And we need to stop talking about who can we push these costs off on. We need to talk about how can we get these costs down.
Well, and today, as Harold points out in the chat room, the Senate's Finance Committee will be talking about the PFD, so expect more takings to happen there. Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budget. You can find links at the top of the chat room video today, or you can just go to Facebook and look up Alaskans for Sustainable Budget. Brad Keithley, as always, my friend, thank you so much. Thank you for sticking over today. I appreciate it.
Michael, as always, thank you for having me. Well, that's a wrap for another week's edition of the weekly top three from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you again for joining us. Remember that you can find past episodes on our YouTube and SoundCloud pages, and keep track of us during the week on Facebook and Twitter. This has been Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We look forward to you joining us again next week on the weekly top three.